And yet I ask you, is not an alien force already among us?
Hi, Veronica. Welcome back. This is part two of our recording together. I'm so glad that you can join me again. This is fantastic. Thank you.
Oh, no, you're welcome. I'm enjoying myself.
That's great. Thanks. It's always good to have a good chat, isn't it, about these things.
Yeah.
It does me so much good. I need it. I wanted to bounce back into some of the things we were discussing in part one, and particularly the notions of the imaginal realm.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you talk to me about that? In Songlines, you explore the concept of this world soul or the imaginal realm. I'm just reading from my notes. Could you explain this in-between space of spirit and matter that manifests in modern phenomena like NDEs, UFOs, and crop circles? Mm. How do you explain that for the viewers, please?
I don't know that I can explain it really. I think I learned a lot from the Sufi mystics about the imaginal realm. And I think because of the completely altered experience that I had with the UFO experience, I became very interested in similar sorts of phenomena. And that's why I read everything I could in the 80s and 90s on near-death experiences, because they seemed also to be in a world that wasn't, that they visited, that had landscapes and guides and cities and angels, and where they were transformed in these phenomenal ways, and sort of would come back and tell their stories. And they're all similarly in, well, Jung called it the psychoid realm.
Psychoid.
Yeah, which is a rather unpleasant name. I don't really like that name. But what he meant by it was, with synchronicity, his whole psychology had to change, really, because you could no longer say that the psyche was within, because it clearly wasn't just within. It was around. I mean, you have a subjective feeling, but also when you experience nature mirroring you in the way that we talked about before,
yes,
you're actually in a field, no pun intended,
yeah,
that you're being held by something much larger than yourself. And right. The ancients call that the world soul, the anima mundi, things like that. And I think UFO encounter phenomena was of a similar thing. So when I started, I was very influenced, particularly by this one Sufi mystic called Surawadi.
Yeah, well, you mentioned him in the beginning of your book, don't you, and about this connection to the bird song that you had.
Yeah, he's connected very much to the hoopoe bird, which has another whole storyline attached to it. The reason I loved reading his work about all of this was because he was very clear about this world between spirit and matter that was subtle. So it was more subtle than physical, but it wasn't completely spiritual. The spiritual world was something else in his mind. And he was absolutely clear that that there was this other sort of in-between world.
Okay.
And I guess because really my experiences and mystical experiences I've had since a child, I feel like I've dipped into that. I call it the other world. It's the between world, the imaginal world. And it's accessed really by the heart. It's the organ of knowing that resides in the heart. So you, as he says about journeys to the imaginal world, there's some kind of break with ordinary reality that happens to enter these, but you can't describe how it is. It's like when I was describing my UFO encounter to you, I couldn't tell you that moment in time and space about how it shifted. It just did. And so you can't ever explain really or tell anyone else how to get there, because you don't really know yourself how you got there. So, but I think, and then when he went on to describe these cities, these mystical cities, there was something in me that just knew that I knew what he was talking about, which sounds completely nuts.
I know. You're never going to take the empiricist along with you with that kind of assertion, are you? But you just know, don't you? This.
Yeah.
I know.
It's a knowing. It's direct knowing. There are different kinds of knowing. There's knowing about. There's knowing, you know, from direct experience, but then there's also becoming what you know. And that's what you were talking about just as we were
It's that ring of truth, isn't it? I love that phrase, the ring of truth. There's, you know, it's like when someone says something in a room spontaneously, they've just constructed a bunch of words together to make a sentence, and everybody responds and goes, ah, because it resonates deeply within everybody sitting at the dinner table. You know, it's got that ring of truth about it.
Exactly. And that's what his work helped me. It helped elaborate for me this, perhaps in a more poetic way, I don't really know, but he was talking about an ontologically real world that was between spirit and matter. And I feel we have lots of examples of that, certainly in the mystic literature, near-death literature, UFO encounter, crop circle phenomena, the same thing. I mean, you're talking about these experiences that are so powerful and really take you elsewhere.
So for me, there's this connection, okay, between the psychedelic experience. My teacher used to say the most important part, if you could try and catch it, which is like catching the moment, as soon as you try and catch it, it's gone. The next, try and catch the coming on. Try and catch the change from when you've taken the psychedelic and then you're waiting for it to happen. And then when it happens, you won't remember when it happened and how it shifted. And if you can get to that point where it shifts, you'll recognize it in other areas, like walking into a crop circle or like walking into a room where something spiritual is going to happen. That was his kind of idea. It does make sense, doesn't it? And I've taken people to crop circles. My second son and his partner, they wanted to go to a crop circle. My second son had been to them since he was little, but his partner hadn't. And so I took them. And she actually said, it feels like I'm on mushrooms. And I've had a lot of people say that to me when I've taken to crop circles. It feels like I'm tripping.
Yeah, well, the energy can be really strong inside. Yeah. In fact, that happened in 2012 for me, going into the Stanton St. Bernard. Yeah, Stanton. I always get the name wrong.
What, in the Hummingbird?
Mm-hmm.
In the Hummingbird.
No, the cathedral one.
Oh, okay. Yeah, another one. The cathedral one. Yeah.
Yeah, it just stuck because it was added onto a couple of times, wasn't it? So it was just after the round visit. One end came.
Okay.
It was 2012, I know, because I spoke at the Crop Circle conference that year. And so I was there for that, but this third part had just come down literally the day before I got to Heathrow. So I rushed down there and next day went in, and it was one that you couldn't see from the road, so I didn't know exactly where it was, but there was this group going in from Belgium, I think. And so I joined them because they were coming back a second time. And then we were about to approach the perimeter, so I could see that the edge of it was coming up. And I said, you know, I really want to just kind of go into this myself, so I'm just going to separate.
Okay, that's wise.
And the strangest thing happened, I swear to God. I stepped over the threshold and immediately my whole body filled up with this, again, it was just like this unconditional love. It was so powerful. And my eyes filled with tears. I mean, I was so moved immediately. It's like, I can't tell you when it happened. It's one of those things it did. And I don't know whether it was a voice or a knowing. I don't know if it was in my head or in the atmosphere or in the field. I have no idea where it was, but it conveyed sort of, not exactly non-verbally, but kind of, that it was made by Syrians.
Okay.
And Okay, it was made by Zurich. And then I spent, maybe a couple of hours and ended up at the thing right at the bottom and just basically was meditating. I mean, I was altered state of consciousness completely anyway.
And what about your experience of time when you were in there?
I don't know because I'm saying I was there for a couple of hours. I know it was a long time, but actually, I don't know how long I was.
I've taken people, and I remember taking a friend of mine once to a crop circle, and when we come out, he said, "Right, you better get me back to work now," because he'd sort of come from. And I said, "What time do you think it is?" And he went, "Well, it's about 2 o'clock," and I was like, "It's 6:30."
I know. It's that missing time thing
It
again.
freaked him out. That tangible, he was really freaked by
I
that.
can imagine. Because you don't normally have those sorts of experiences necessarily.
I wanted to tell you when, a story. This was obviously earlier. The picture on the front of your book, it was earlier than 2012. It was like 2009, I think. So, can I tell you a story about that formation?
Please.
So there was a journalist called Ginger Casey, quite a famous journalist from the States, and I ended up, like, without doing adverts, ended up doing lots and lots of tours for all sorts of really, the chairman of the Bank of
Amazing.
Mexico, the chairman and his wife of the Bank of Santander in
Oh,
Colombia,
wonderful.
gurus from India who've, like, honestly,
How fabulous. Well, you
amazing
knew so much
experiences.
about it.
And one of them was Ginger Casey. I got a call from Michael Glickman saying, "I was a journalist here and she'd like a guide, when you take her around the crop circles." And she said, "Yeah, okay, we arranged for the following day." So I picked her up and I took her to, do you remember that crop circle that was like, it was like half a crop circle that was up against a fence? It was as if it was spinning through lots and lots of arms of circles that were getting smaller as they went out, and it sort of was half a crop circle and it went into a field of grass the other side over a fence. Do you remember that one?
No,
Okay, so
oh
I took her there, and she had this little camcorder, and she told me she was a journalist, and she was an anchor woman for a certain news channel, and blah blah, retired now, sort of semi-retired.
no.
And then she goes to me, "Oh, will you hold my camera up? I want to talk to the camera." So I says, "Yeah, sure." And then she became this powerful news reader. I remember going, "Oh my God," do you know what I mean? She changed her persona on me,
Oh,
like, she went
camera.
from this sort of like, yeah, this really just sort of regular lady to this bang. I was like, "Oh my God, I'm here, I am in this crop circle," and rah, rah, rah. And I'd sort of taken her around and showed her some things which blew her mind, right? First of all, the uneven ground, and then I showed her there were these tracer lines that were around the edge of the crop circle that were going in the opposite contraflow direction that Dan and I talked about in his book. So she gave this report to the crop circle. So then we drive off, and I'm taking her towards Stanton St. Bernard, right? And there was the owl formation, like owl eyes, on top of Woodborough Hill. I took her there first, and then along the road to this, okay, a hummingbird. So on the way, I said to her, "What brought you here? Well, how comes you've come across on a plane from the States to look at the crop circles? Big journalists like you." So, "Well, my mum died recently." And she said, "And I was having trouble sleeping, after, waking up. And I kept getting this thing about fractals in my mind." So she said, "I got up at 3 in the morning and started Googling fractals. And crop circles came up." So she thought, "What's this?" She started looking into it. And it eventually moved her enough to want to come to England to
Oh,
have a
that's
look, a
wonderful.
closer look. That's what led her to me that day. So then we walk into this crop circle of the hummingbird. And she walks around. And I usually had this practice where I didn't show people what they were walking into. I wanted to sort of get their realization when I showed them the picture afterwards and they've had a wander around, So I did that, and she wandered around, and then she comes back to me because, and I also like to observe the emotional change on people in various different crop circles. So I'd seen her reaction in the first one, very, very journalistic, very, looking at the facts, matter of fact. Second one, the owl eyes, she was starting to shift with the owl eyes. By the time we got to this, she walked around, and when she came back, you could tell she was quite emotional. And she said to me, "What's the picture? What are we standing in?" And I showed her the picture then, the photograph of the hummingbird, and she broke down. Okay. And so when, you know, eventually when I consoled her and we sort of went over in the corner and had a chat, she said, my whole memory of my mother growing up was that she used to put little pictures of hummingbirds everywhere.
Oh, that's so beautiful.
Fridge magnets. And,
yeah.
And so the coincidence of fact that her mother's passing had led her to the crop circles and then this crop circle had been a hummingbird.
Beautiful. That's so touching.
Yeah. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Just one of those stories along the way.
Such a gift. And it's just, that's where you feel there is a response going on, you know, for someone who's really... Well, as you say, it started off matter of fact, but kind of progressed into being a more open stage, and then, wow.
And then over the years after that, we watched her struggle with that because she was so moved by it. She went back to the States, and she was friends with Shirley. What's her name? Shirley.
Okay.
Yeah. And who dismissed it out of hand? You know, just didn't want to know, and all of her friends didn't want to know, and so it affected her.
Of course it did.
Because she wasn't accepted. And then she turned a little bit against the crop circle, started to interview the hoaxers. And so I've seen that many times. I've seen people get moved by them and then explain it away because, you know, they're not being accepted with their friends enough.
It's so painful when that happens.
Isn't it?
It's so hard. Yeah, it's really awful.
Yeah, that's part and parcel of it as well. So yeah. You mentioned earlier about your teacher and you mentioned about Pleiadians and Syrians so far. So I've always struggled with this sort of stuff. You know, I've met people at Glastonbury Festival who've probably had a little bit too much acid who tell me that they're channeling stuff from the Pleiadian Starfleet commander. And I'm a little bit skeptical. But
oh, no.
As I think you should be sometimes. But yeah. You mentioned the Star Nations.
Yeah.
On emerging interest. Tell me about me about that, Veronica.
Well, I just don't have a problem with it. And part of the reason I don't is because I can't believe we're alone in the universe. It doesn't make
sense. I agree.
For indigenous cultures, the Star Nation people are their ancestors, they're their guides, they're in regular contact with them. And it just seems perfectly normal to me, I'm afraid. I really don't have a problem with it. I don't talk about it really very much. But when certain events happen, I feel encouraged to be a bit bolder about it. And that was one very clear example of feeling that they were, for whatever reasons, were communicating that they had had a hand in that, the creation of that formation. I guess I feel that, well, I guess I don't know what the creative force behind these formations is, but if it does, at least sometimes, involve sophisticated, benign, benevolent star beings who have always been connected to the earth and the earth's evolution. I mean, Egypt, for example, is a prime example of a culture that was completely connected with the stars. It was a star culture. So was Sumer and Mesopotamia. It seems to me that we've lost these larger contexts of who and what other kinds of beings inhabit our galaxy and that are connected with our Earth and care about the evolution of Earth. So I don't broadcast it all over the place, but when I had an experience like that, when I had an experience with the Pleiadians in my encounter experience and the missing time, I'm fine with it. I know there are many other civilizations out there and people say they're connected to Lyrians and Arcturians and Orion, all of this. That's fine with me. The ones I've only had personal experience with are Pleiadian guides and
Syrian. That one with Assyrian. Do you get the sense, I'll say that I do, over the years it's evolved, where I've thought, I used to describe it as like I walk in one crop circle and it was almost like walking around an art gallery where you had Da Vinci's and Monet's and you felt a different brushstroke, a certain yeah. different style or an influence to the design and to the feel inside.
Yeah.
And so I've come to, and it, again, these are always theories that you can't prove. This is part and parcel of it, isn't it? But, you know, this joint enterprise to help us through this transition period is a nice story, isn't it? That there's a bunch of different active forces, some of them physical, maybe from other stars or planets, and then more ethereal kinds of entities that maybe live in the imaginal realm that are also assisting it from their part. I've come to sort of put that together in a kind of joint effort that's all working with us and around us and through us to...
Yeah.
Does that sort of sit with you?
That makes sense. Yeah, I think that's because I'm sure the Fae realms and, you know, maybe they work in tandem with the star beings. I don't know.
No, we don't know. This is it.
No.
It's like I've said before when I've talked about these things. I've said, you know, I like the idea that there's this generic, whatever it is, and it presents itself to us in a way that we would best accept without being frightened.
Yeah.
My work in South America, where the Virgin Mother has appeared, you know, and I've been to Aparecida in Brazil, and I've been to a bunch of different places. I went to see John of God, and I've been to a bunch of faith healers that do miraculous things, and so on, to get a feel for how they relate to this mysterious kind of energy that they either work with or use or handle or whatever. And that's always been of interest to me.
Yeah.
And in the end, I think that the explanations and the language are about as that. I like Scott Onstott's phrase, for example, that says the language is a map and not the territory.
Yeah.
The words point towards consciousness; they're not consciousness. And so, when we're dealing with consciousness, then maybe we have to make these images up, use the imaginal realm and what our role is in it to conjure up these kinds of. Again, it's all on the table. It's not. Yeah, it's not.
I know. I don't think it's anything you can. Certainly, from my point of view, it's not something you can prove.
No, exactly.
It's the way, as you're saying, that I partly imagine just from my experiences, really how it might how they might, but there could be many ways in which these formations come down. I don't have to be a fundamentalist about it.
That's it. And I think that's what the crop circles have taught me, is that because of all of that, you don't need to be a fundamentalist. That, in fact, fundamentalism of this is the way and this is the argument is you know, that's why I like temporary temples as a phrase, because we don't fight over it if it's a temporary temple. It's not that. That's not the sacred part of it. The sacred part of it is this experience in consciousness.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. It is. I think it is. You know, Jung always says that in any theory, there's a personal equation there. You just can't get around it. And I think from, just very early on, I had a propensity, a kind of way of seeing the world that has really not changed that much from when I was really small. And I think, you know, I'm not stuck to that, that view, but it is a particular bias, I might even say. Not a rigid thing, just I remember when I, after I finished A-levels and I went to work on the kibbutz that summer.
Okay.
And I had, you know, I was picking apples, you know, 4 a.m, whatever, till 10, because it was hot. And then this girlfriend and I kind of hitchhiked around the country, as you do when you're 18.
Yeah.
And went to the various places. Well, I just remember very clearly one day at the Sea of Tiberias, Sea of Galilee, you know, I had this kind of opening, standing there on the edge of the water. And it was this, I just suddenly saw the material world as this kind of, I don't know how to say, a kind of veil through which the spirit was displaying itself. Now, I'm putting words to that, which doesn't sound terribly inspiring, but in that moment, it was just like, wow, You know, things are coming through into this world that's very solid, but it's like the two belong together. And I think, you know, I just think there's something about all the phenomena we're talking about that kind of brings those two together.
Yeah, the indivisibility and the divisibility. It's another phrase I used to use.
Yeah.
When those two things exist in simultaneously.
Yeah, multiplicity within unity.
Yeah. Talking of Jung, so Marie-Louise von Franz was, would you say she was his protege? She was his number one?
Yeah, she was certainly an intellectual giant like he was.
She said that number was the primary archetype.
Yeah, she did.
Number being related to geometry, and therefore we're dealing with that. And then Jung's work, I remember watching a lecture on by Zitzek Mihaly about the flow state. And his whole life had unfolded with that research because he'd attended a lecture on UFOs and it was hosted by Carl Jung. Did you know that?
No.
Mihaly Zitzek Mihaly, his whole work on the flow state came about because he attended a lecture. He was a student, and he didn't know what to do for a day, and there was a lecture on UFOs and it was given by Carl Jung.
Yeah. I love that Jung was so interested in this.
Yes. And he said, Mihaly said, that Jung's theory was that people, patients were presenting to him saying that they were seeing sort of UFOs or geometry in the sky. And he believed that it was due to the trauma of the Second World War, due to the assault that their psyche had experienced, that the geometry was manifesting as a way to reintegrate to make them whole again.
Yeah.
Do you see a connection between that and the crop circles in the physical manifestation of the crop circles?
Well, Jung's interesting in that essay, actually, because he talks at the beginning about how UFO phenomena always comes at the change of a big age. And that's where I started to get this idea about signatures. Like, what are the signatures that begin to speak to the fact that we're in a big change? And how do they all fit together? Or maybe they don't fit together and stuff like that. But then he moves, as he does so often, to a very symbolic approach. And so when he gives all the clinical material, he kind of veers away from the reality of UFOs to their symbolic significance.
Okay.
And I think that has value, for
yes.
sure.
Yes.
You know, he said things like people were searching for a new spirituality. And I, you know, yeah, okay, I think that's probably true, too.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with that. But there's a wonderful story at the end of that essay that many people don't know about. And he gives this example of a man in, I think, on the West Coast somewhere, who had this interesting name, Orfeo Angelucci.
Wow. I mean,
it sounds like something out of Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great name. Orfeo Angelucci.
Yeah. And he tells the story of this Orfeo. And he tells it as if these events really happened to this man. So he kind of goes back to sort of where he suggested he might be starting, having gone through all the symbolic material. And then he comes back to the real story of this man. And then, you know, and then he, it's a wonderful story. It's certainly worth reading.
Oh, I shall.
Yeah, it's really fantastic because it's about how the ETs showed him, you know, what was happening to the earth through our misuse of attitude, the environment. It was really quite a lovely story. But then he also had these mystical sacred marriages in his trips out into the galaxy. I mean, it was really extraordinary. But then he riffs on the guy's name and talks about, you know, if his name really was that, you know, Angel Angelucci, that you know, there's something about these events that are messages from beyond. And I like that implication.
I love that. Yeah. I love that. Yeah.
So
I really love that.
I'm not sure I answered your question, but
Yeah, well, that's it, isn't it? It's what it makes you think of when you put these questions. And if that's a great story, that's a great story.
So that's how I see that essay. But, you know, he He was really interested, as he says in a letter somewhere, in the odd, what doesn't fit, what's off the beaten track. And that's part of the reason I like Jung, because he was ahead of his time in so much of this stuff. Now, he didn't go into crop circles because they hadn't started appearing, perhaps. You know, he died in 61. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was very, very open to stuff. It's one of the things I enjoy about reading his letters, for example, because he's the two big fat volumes of all his correspondence. And, you know, he wanders mightily from his written theoretical things. And it's just so refreshing to
I've got Memories, Dreams, Reflections on my shelf. I've got UFOs and I've got the Synchronicity book.
Yeah.
I've also got Man and His Symbols, but I've never finished Man and His Symbols.
Yeah, it's kind of a bit coffee tape. It's like you can dip into it, but it's not really from beginning to end, kind of.
So I've picked it up and gone, right, I'm going to finish this. And then I end up putting it down and getting something else.
Yeah.
There's always gems in there, but yeah.
Yeah.
When I first got encountered the crop circles, to be honest, I knew nothing. I started an A-level in psychology at that time, just before then. Didn't finish it.
Yeah.
And then all these things happened to me, and I went to the bookstore, and I ended up buying Modern Man in Search of His Soul.
Yeah, I like that essay.
But at the time, it was totally, totally way above my ability to understand the language he was using, and it was too heavy for me at that time. I had to keep stopping and looking up words and what does this mean, and then you've got to understand the concept of what that word is. But I come back to it now, having advanced my knowledge a bit. It's a fantastic essay, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really good. It's one of my favorites, actually. Yeah. I think I read that when I was very young. For some reason, in our house, we had all these Jung books. I have no idea how or why, because my parents never, in fact, they were very skeptical about any kind of psychology. So.
Really?
Mm.
Isn't that funny? How were they there then?
I have no idea. But that was one of them.
Was it really?
Something before I left home, pretty much at 18. Yeah.
Modern Man.
I don't know, but when I read, so I was 21, I read Memories, Dreams and Reflections. I just moved to New York in this mad sort of escape from my English family.
You went to New York to get some peace from that, did you?
As one does.
Yeah.
So I remember I was working that first year at, this was 72.
Wow.
For 10, 12 years, I lived in New York, and it was just the place to be. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. Women's movement, social justice, liberation theology was just fantastic period of time. But I was on the train going to my job, and I had Memories, Dreams, and Reflections, and I was so glommed on to the text. It was one of those texts that changed my life, really. And I ended up somewhere in the Bronx. I had no idea where I was. And I was slightly terrified of being in New York anyway. Anyway, that's just to say how
important. You got so distracted in the book that you ended up in the Bronx on the train.
Yeah.
That must have been a little scary. I've ended up in favelas accidentally in Brazil, and that was a little scary.
Yeah.
The imaginal wisdom and the future, with the growing interest in the phenomena like crop circles, which it is growing. I notice now that videos are being put out and there's, a lot of views on people are watching. Karen's convinced. We had a conversation last week, Karen and I, and we're going to do a little project together. I think you're going to be involved in it, maybe.
You mentioned about the YouTube.
Yeah. Yeah. Because and Andy Thomas as well, another of my peers amongst the crop circles, or my elders really, like Karen, they're all feeling that there's a growing interest, and therefore we suddenly, and Andy said it to me and it made me feel a little strange really, but he's right. It's like now's our time to start sort of like just putting out there what we know, and it's it's for people. And we've kind of developed the attitudes now where we're not fundamentalists. We're not going to run at me and try and convince people. No, we're just going to lay out our experiences, like these conversations. Yeah. So this podcast is my kind of way of doing that, really.
It's a brilliant way of doing it. I really love it. I just looked at all the names. Oh, my goodness. I'm really apologize. I just really just don't know enough about you and your work. But now I will.
Oh, that's great. Thank you. For that. Oh, yeah. I really want you to listen to Karen's essay on the call, the one that I recorded with this Morgan Freeman voice.
Oh, that's hilarious.
It's great. And there's a bunch of other stuff on there as well. The video of 777 that I made at the Times on there. And
I agree. I think, you know, the energies. At the moment, the astrology and all of this is so intense. I think it's a brilliant time to really start putting this out there. I think there's a real, often I get invited to do, you know, talks on other people's summits, and sometimes I'll say, well, is there anything particular you want me to talk about? And quite often it's, crop circles. We don't know enough about crop circles.
Yeah. Funny, isn't it?
Yeah. But I don't have the wealth of knowledge that you do. Oh my God.
Well, it's just time served, as they say. Kung Fu means time served. Did you know that? The term Kung Fu means hard working man over time. It means putting the hours in. So it's just that, really. Yeah.
Committed to it. Yeah.
Done the Kung Fu.
Wonderful. Yeah. Truly.
So my question to you was going to be, okay, do you think, what do you think the future holds for humanity's relationship to the imaginary realm? We've talked about that's there, and it's this in-between world, it's this other world separate from spirit, and it's about our transformation moving away from the sort of destruction we're seeing around us into a new paradigm. The younger people, I've always felt, the younger people are the ones that have obviously... They've got to grab it and take it and do whatever they're going to do with it. You said that time wise, obviously, we hope that it's going to be sooner rather than later, but we're not sure. And I think that's probably a wise position to hold rather than get invested in. It's going to be around the corner, like we discussed. But how do you see potentially this future unfolding?
Well, you know, on Mondays, Wednesdays, Fridays, on Saturday or Sunday, I feel enormous hope, I have to say.
You're optimistic.
Yeah.
I was talking to my daughter recently, because my daughter's, she's been involved in all this since she was little, dragged into crop circles like all of them, she enormously respects my work, but at the same time, like some of the other things that have come off of, this research, like for example about media lies and propaganda and what's going on and the dissolution of society and politics and so on, that you inevitably talk about, because it kind of all joins together, doesn't it? We've always had a difficulty together, my daughter and I, with regards to that, but at the same time, we were having this conversation a week or so ago, and I think she was surprised to hear me say, "I'm optimistic about all this." I think she's, and it made me kind of step back, because I think for years she's thought that all me bringing up all this sort of negative stuff about what's going on with the politicians and the media and stuff has led her to believe that I've got a pessimistic view of.
Oh, it might have done, yeah.
Yes, yeah, and this was a week or two ago, and we were having this conversation, and she said, "Dad, I'm loving the optimism."
Oh, wonderful!
You know,
well, it's wonderful that she can say that as a young person, because so many young people are deeply affected by the environmental issue and the world is going. I mean, this is the world they've grown up in.
I know.
So it's wonderful that she feels good, that you feel good about.
Yeah, I think she was surprised that I've ultimately got an optimistic view. So I really do think that it's going to, I think we've got some tough times ahead, no doubt.
Yeah.
We're going through them now, I think.
Yes,
we are. And I don't see that changing for a few years at least. I think the birthing pains, as it were, of us moving into this new paradigm are definitely apparent.
Yeah.
But I am optimistic.
Yeah. I am too. I always feel that when I look up at the stars at night or crop circles and contemplate these sorts of realities, I feel like it's all so much larger than me. And, you know, the Earth has been here for I don't know how many billions of years. And we're on it for 80, 90, 100, you know. And I think with vision, it's important to, you know, I feel that I want to be optimistic. And I feel that a lot of the things that have happened in my lifetime, you know, I'm in my kind of approaching mid-70s now.
Yeah.
But when I do that looking back thing, you know, that you were talking about, and you see the pattern, and you think, God, I didn't know at the time any of that was fitting. And then you look at the larger pattern, and I go back to my, you know, all the experiences I've had since a child, where that's taken me in my life, and giving me treasures beyond measure, really. And then when I look around at my kind of community of people, like crop circle researchers like yourself and other people who are committed to, you know, these new developments in consciousness, I do feel really good about it, actually.
Yeah,
I do. I feel it's all going somewhere, and everybody's just, you know, playing a part, and it's all going to move towards something, and I just feel it will.
Excuse me. There's a just outside my house here now. There's a flea market going on along the road.
Where are you?
So I'm in Bristol.
Oh yeah, that's where my brother lives. I know Bristol.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So I'm in Eastfield, which is a very multicultural area. I'm right by Eastfield Park, which I love.
Mm.
And there's a every it's usually in the last Saturday of the month, but they're doing an extra one this month too. Protest for or to raise money for the Palestinian people, and so I walked down this one. I didn't know it was on. I said, I love it because the vibe, the energy. It's like the old Rainbow Circle festivals when we used to have market day on a Saturday and people got all their tat out, you know, to sell. And and so I decorate my flat with little glass bottles or little ornaments, the objet d'art that I find, you know, these little. Anyway, I walked down there earlier, and there's a lot of books get sold, and. I always look through the books because I'm a book fiend. And there was a book on Aristotle. I've never really read much of Aristotle. I've done a bit on Plato, and been reading Gorgias recently, the dialogue with the military general, you know.
Amazing.
And, you know, tell me about courage, Socrates says, and then makes this man realize he knows nothing about courage and he should be an expert on courage because he's a military general. So it's hilarious. Hilarious
stuff. I love that stuff.
Anyway, I picked this book up on Aristotle, and the guy who's sort of selling it says, oh, it's a great book, that is deep book. And I said, oh yeah, I've never really read any Aristotle. I said, then he says to me, oh, he was Plato's teacher. I said, no, he was Plato's student, you know, Socrates then Plato. So the guy next to me, young man next to me, starts up this conversation. We end up having this fantastic conversation, and I really get my heart warmed up with these kinds of conversations, particularly with young people, because they're so curious.
Yeah.
And he was so absorbed in just a few things that I'd said, and then we ended up having this, and he, oh, come and sit down, and we ended up having this chat. And I love spontaneous moments like that, because you really feel like soul work is going on, not just for them, but for me. Right, right.
Yeah,
just happened earlier, just before we started recording.
That's brilliant. There's a place where Jung says that he thinks that life is made up largely of invisible acts. And that story that you just told reminds me of that. That matters, that meeting that happened.
Absolutely.
And the enthusiasm and the spirit that was released by your communion with these other people. It's so beautiful. It's so hot.
It is. And I've grown...
It really matters.
And I've grown a sense of feeling that those moments really matter, and I take a great deal of joy out of them, because they are those. I want to say charitable, but it's not charitable. It's like where you do something, you know, like a philanthropist who does. I'm saying this wrong because I don't want to come across like that. It's just like when you do something that's completely unrecognized. The invisible act is probably the best phrase for it, isn't it? Because nobody will get to see that. Only the three of us will have enjoyed what it was. And
but it will filter out somehow.
Somehow.
Yeah, it will.
Yeah. It's hard to say, isn't it? It's hard to... Yeah. You can, but you, I know that you understand. I get that sense that you know what I mean.
I get it intuitively and on a feeling level too. Mm. Because when I was working mostly with patients, as I did in the beginning, you know, I used to think, wow, the work that's going on in here, no one knows about. It's in this little alchemical chamber and it's just the person in me where things happen. Talking happens and other things happen. You know, this the field, here we go again, is such a huge part of that.
Yeah.
And that's why I love quantum physics, really, because it talks a lot about this kind of quantum field that we're all tuning into, I think, partly from the point of view of science is what we're talking about as well. But yeah, it matches those things. It filters in and somehow it informs the whole. I don't know
it how does. What came to mind then as you were saying that was when I did some research about the breath, you know, the word psyche comes from this psychane, doesn't it? It means to breathe or to blow.
Yeah.
And when I was doing some research for a talk about that some years back, this ritual of the Native Americans of sitting in a circle and inviting the invisible in with them.
Yeah.
And blowing the smoke out of the pipe to see the spiral, the way the air spiraled, and that was the mystical, that was the invisible thing being made visible that they'd invited to join them, the spirit of it.
Yeah.
It's cool stuff, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think we're probably getting to the end of it now, aren't we? I think we've covered and chewed the cud.
I think we've somehow you got me talking. I thought I wouldn't have much to say because but you're extremely good at being very calm and making, certainly I felt very comfortable right away. So
I'm doing my job.
I went out the window.
I get nervous before these things and I think, oh God, I don't know enough and what am I going to do and I've got to ask the questions. And
it's so funny that, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it's in the moment it's real and then usually you get going and it just goes into that flow. It feels like it went into a flow. That was lovely.
Did to me too. Yeah. Oh, thanks so much for that. Yeah. It's like that with presentations as well. Sometimes, you know, before you go and stand on stage, like, oh my God.
Oh, freak out. Yeah.
I actually get more scared now if I'm not nervous.
Yes.
There's something wrong if you're not nervous. You should be nervous. You're going to stand in.
I'll try and notice it when it does.
Oh, Veronica, I want to plug your book. I haven't.
You're sweet. Thank you.
It's such a great book. So thank you so much.
The funny thing is, it was published in 2012. It sells better now than it did then.
There you go. But so I think
there's a little thermometer barometer.
I have a feeling it's going to sell more in the next few years as well. I really do. So people are latching onto it, and your work and your expertise and the mind that is you, the soul that is you, that's brought this to bear. Oh, there is one thing I wanted to say. The title, Songlines. When I first found out about the Aboriginal Dreamtime and that the songlines were a map of the landscape that brought their dreamtime into the physical world, they had a physical purpose as well.
Yeah.
Can you just tell me, as a last little anecdote, what was your inspiration for using songlines for the songs?
You know what? It was the weirdest thing. The title actually came before I even knew what I was talking about.
Really?
It did. It was always that. It was just always that title. I didn't have to struggle with it. It was just, that's all it was. And then I thought, I better find out what song lines are. And then when I looked it up, and I also loved the Greek oime, which is a song. Oime in Greek is a song, but it's also a path into another world.
Oh, I've never heard that.
Yeah. And I think that it became clear to me Well, there's another whole story about Australia, but we can't divert into that now.
Okay. Another episode coming in the future then, for sure.
Yeah, my grandfather, my paternal grandfather.
Really?
He was a missionary and worked with the Aborigines. And he collected Aboriginal art. And I always felt that he was more impressed by Aboriginal culture than the Christian one in the end.
And see, again, we could go into, there's the connection with the acacia tree that's on the flag of Australia that contains DMT and the Aboriginal's dream time. And it's all connected in that way, isn't it?
It's all connected. So, yeah, I was very drawn. And we did go to Australia a few years ago. And I had great difficulty there, actually, because of the tension between the white culture and the Aboriginal culture. But we did get out of Sydney to go and find where my grandfather had in the early part of the 1900s. And yeah, he'd had his parishes, and there's still a lot of Indigenous culture there, which was really wonderful. And they had, there was this fair, just not a large fair, but a lot of Aboriginals. And I could talk to the women, and it was just an extraordinary experience. But yeah, powerful, powerful culture for sure. But we did digress.
Well, we did, but I was going to come back to, so I put forward the theory some years ago that I believe that the location of Wiltshire, the Ridgeway Path was a songline.
You know, that's so funny you just said that, because I think I mentioned it somewhere, but we lived in Sussex, but then we lived in London, and we would journey down to North Devon, where my family had a home. And as a child, I remember being in the car, driving down, there was no motorway at that point, and we would come to Wiltshire, and the energy just shifted. It totally shifted. And I could pick it up. Of course, I couldn't say anything to anyone, because they would have, you know. I really felt, and I still feel that to this day. Yeah. It's just so beautiful.
Oh, yeah. There's something about that place. There's no doubt that, and it seems to be in other places in South America as well, where people pilgrimage to, because they just intuitively or whatever felt that this is a place we need to go. And, you know, I suppose moths to a flame, really, in that sort of sense. And they just go there. But the Ridgeway Path has existed for 6,000 years or whatever, and has never been interrupted. And the naming of all the hills, Knapp Hill and Golden Ball Hill and Martins Hill Hill and all these things, to me, if they made a pathway through into Wales to get the stones to bring them back for Stonehenge and so on and so forth, they must have had maps, and those maps must have been songlines. And the Druids, these keepers of knowledge that came from Wales and sort of did these things, I think, I'm fairly convinced. Perfect
portal opening for Crop Circle.
Right, connections. Yeah. There's an author called Bob Trubshaw, who wrote a book called Songlines of Avebury.
Oh, beautiful. I'd love to look at that.
There's a lot of etymology in it about the words of Swallowhead Springs and all those sorts of things around the area. I had a copy of it when I went to Mexico. I left it with my son. I can't find it now. And it's about 50 quid on Amazon now. I'm gutted.
You'd have to go to some second-hand books.
That is second-hand.
Oh.
It's because it's not pretty. I know.
Oops. Okay, Songlines of, what was it called?
Let me just double check. It's Songlines, I'm sure it's Songlines of Avebury. Bob Trubshaw, hang on a sec, I'll just get it for you. Singing Up the Country, the Songlines of Avebury.
Wow, what a beautiful title.
Yeah, and then I've met Bob, I interviewed him back in 2012, and he's a great, great guy. Really did excellent work on that book. It's got so much.
And how do you spell his last name?
Trubshaw, Trubshaw.
Okay. Oh, Trubshaw, okay.
Trubshaw,
yeah. Brilliant. Well, I'll hope springs eternal. I'll look it up and see if
there's... you'll probably find a copy for 10 quid now and grab it.
If I do.
Veronica, thanks so much for joining me. It's been an absolute pleasure.
It's been an absolute pleasure and delight both to meet you and to have this wonderful conversation together. Thank you very much.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thanks very much. Okay.